give you a heart of flesh. I will put my spirit within you. I will take the initiative, and you will obey my statutes and carefully observe my regulations. God is literally promising to do in you and for you what you can't do for yourself.
Amen.
Who says, again, who says that God has to go through all this effort? He loves us. He could just put a sign up saying, warning, no lifeguard on duty, swim at your own risk. He could hang up the Ten Commandments on the wall, and when time goes by, he could come back and say, well, how did you do? But no, he does not do that. He is pursuing us every step of the way. He says, you're dirty. He says, if you're dirty, he says, I will cleanse you. If you got idols, I will get rid of them. If you have a stony heart, I will give you a new one. If you're cold and indifferent, I will help you feel again. You can't obey. You can't do what's right. He says, I will empower you to obey. So the question is, do you have any more objections? What's your objection to listening to God? In Isaiah chapter 5, that we read earlier, he says, what more can I do for my vineyard beyond what I've already done? What more can he do for us? Clearly, God is not passive in the midst of the great controversy. God is pursuing us. Why? Because God is not willing that any should be lost. God loves us too much. For Jesus, heaven was not a place to be desired while we were lost. Jesus does not want to be in heaven while we are lost. And he proved it.
And
he came here. The people are lost at the end of time, not because God didn't provide ample provision. They're lost because they refuse to take up God on his amazing offer. Many of us are shaming ourselves out of heaven. And this is... Please listen to this real close. I speak and talk to people, and I can see the shame in them because of how Satan is making them feel. It's Satan that's making you feel that shame in your heart. We are believing the lies. We tell ourselves we're not good enough. You'll never be good enough. God's standards are too high and our abilities are too low. Whatever your thoughts may be, we're shaming ourselves out of heaven. We're allowing the devil himself and the people around us to do it. We're receiving the unbelief of the people around us instead of receiving the faith of Jesus. We're tuning out the faith of Jesus in favor of accusation, condemnation, and shame. And God is trying to speak to our hearts in the midst of all this. From Genesis to Revelation, God is speaking the truth into life of his people who are continually believing lies. Why? Because of Revelation 12 says there is what? An accuser of the brethren. He understands that when you take hold of God's belief in you, things will change when we take hold of the belief. He's afraid of the faith of Jesus, and that's why he feeds our minds with all this garbage. And who are we? He says, this is garbage about who we are and what we are worth. Many are lost by not taking hold of God's belief in them. God believes in us. They did not realize, they did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. As 2 Thessalonians chapter 2, verse 10. I want to read that again. They did not receive the love of the truth that they might be saved. What is the love of the truth? I mean, what is it? The Word tells us, it says that faith comes by hearing, and hearing by the Word of God. Do we have things in our lives that are more important than this? Do we treat the things in our lives more important than this? I mean, if you have an occupation, do you know your occupation better than you know this? If you have things in your life, do you know them better than you know this? This is everything to the Christian. It's more important than your job, your occupation, your whatever. And I'm talking to myself too. I'm not sitting up here looking to come on you people. I'm talking to myself too. Jeremiah chapter 5, it says, this is starting with verse 20. It says, proclaim this message among the descendants of Jacob. Make it known throughout Judah. Tell them, hear this, you foolish people who have no understanding, who have eyes but do not discern, who have ears but do not perceive. You should fear me, says the Lord. You should tremble all before me. I made the sound, I made the sand a boundary for the sea, a permanent barrier so it could not cross. Its waves may roll, but they can never prevail. They roar, but they never cross that boundary. But these people have a stubborn and rebellious heart. They have turned aside and gone their way. God's creation listens to him. Even there's this author, I don't know if you've heard of him before, David Platt. He nails it. He hits the ball out of the park. It says, we spurn our Creator's authority over us. God beckons storm clouds and they come. He tells the wind to blow and the rain to fall and they immediately obey. He speaks to the mountains, you go there, and he says to the seas, you stop here, and they do it. Everything in all creation responds in obedience to the Creator. Until we get to you and me, we have the audacity to look at God in the face and say, no. I can't think of anything else on planet Earth that says no to God, except for the human being. This is Jeremiah. I think that we are really messed up. When I read this, hopefully you'll agree with me. And hopefully the Holy Spirit is speaking to your heart today. It says, thus says the Lord, stand in the ways and see, and ask for the old paths where the good way is, and walk in it. He's speaking to his people Israel. Then you will find rest for your souls. But they said, we will not walk in it. I mean, he's telling them to find rest for their souls. And they say no. And he says, also I set a watchman over you saying, listen to the sound of the trumpet. But they said, we will not listen. If you look at the story of Israel, their actions show how they listen to God. Verse 18, it says, therefore hear, you nations, and know, O congregation, what is among them. Hear, O earth, behold, I will certainly bring calamity on this people. The fruit of their thoughts, there we go, we go back. God's going to give them over to their thoughts. The fruit of their thoughts. What do we read in Romans chapter 1? That God gave them over to their own thoughts, to go their own way. The entire point is about Jesus, about giving my heart to Him, and they lost sight of that. They missed the point, and in turn, they reaped the consequences by spurning the love and mourning and the grace that God has given them. I want to leave the sermon on good news. Jesus weeps. You know, the shortest verse in the Bible is this: Jesus wept. Jesus weeps not for what was, but for what could have been. That should break each of our hearts. For not what was, but for what could have been. In Isaiah 65:2, you know, this is really, this touches real close to home for me. In Isaiah 65:2, it says, I have stretched out my hand all day long to a rebellious people. I don't know how to say this. I'm not a very good storyteller, but all I can do is just lay it out. And I don't like the story, but this is how I think that this is the problem, one of the problems God has, is if you have a rebellious child, your son, your daughter, and you're standing in the same room and you're trying to get across to them that what they're doing is not right, you're going the wrong way. And as you're in the room with them, they kill themselves. This is hard to think about, that this is going on with God constantly. He is trying to speak to our hearts, and He knows that if we can't hear Him, where it's going to lead. How many billions of times has this happened with God? I don't know how He does it. That would drive the... one of us insane if we had to do this all the time. Let's look at God's picture of this situation. And let's quit looking at us. Look at what God is going through. I think if we could start looking at God and seeing how He's the one that's being hurt, we'll stop. We'll take the focus off of ourselves. God is the one who's being hurt here. God created us for something special. And I can see why Jesus wept, because of what it could have been. This is not where God wanted us to be today. This is terrible. Where is the pearl of great price? I mean, look at this pearl. Does it look like a pearl of great price? No, I believe that's why He gave us the message in Revelation chapter 3. And if you think about the religiosity, if it's even a word, that's not my word from my vocabulary, it just came out. If we look at the religion of Laodicea, it makes, from God's perspective, from Jesus' perspective, it makes Him vomit. And we're called that last day church. We don't think about God's position, but it says that Jesus is knocking on the door of our hearts, Revelation 3:20. And I'll try to wrap this up. I got so much more to say, but it's just, we could stay here all day, and I don't. Anyway, it says that Jesus is knocking on the door of our hearts, and I knew I had some more notes here. this is too good for me to paraphrase. I know there's dead space there. Be patient. We're among friends. If I don't do it, it'll be... The people that Jesus is knocking on the door of their hearts, there's not a person on planet Earth that Jesus is not knocking on that door. And the door he's knocking on are the people that make him want to, what did I say a minute ago? I hate using that word, throw up. He's knocking on the door of everyone's heart. And the thoughts he's thinking, if they will just let me in, then I could do for them what they cannot do for themselves. As he's knocking on that door, he's thinking, maybe they don't hear me. Maybe they don't hear me. The word tells us he's knocking on our door. Don't turn him away. Been here since before, he's been here since eternity, before he created the world. And he has been with every human being since creation. And he's knocked on every door. Don't allow this great salvation to bypass you. Open that door and let him in. He says, I will come in and I will do for you what you cannot do for yourself.
Amen.
Father, we thank you so much that you love us this much. We thank you that you loved us so much that you couldn't live in heaven without us, that you had to come here to help us, that we could allow the Holy Spirit to make these changes in our heart. That we could be used of you, that we could be your witnesses in this world. That this work could be finished, and that we could allow you to do what we cannot do for ourselves. We thank you, Father, that you love us this much. We praise you because you are worthy of our praise and our thanks and our glory and your glory. And all glory and honor is yours. It's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. I want to turn the microphone over to my good friend Ray. We have a special presentation.
Thank you, Mr. Ricky. If I could have Ms. Novelette. Place to be able to see you two wonderful ladies. All right, as you all know, Ms. Patty's going to be leaving us next Sabbath, and this is Ms. Donnellette's last Sabbath with us. And I just want to say from the church that we appreciate you two ladies so much. You just don't even know. I know what you feel. Leaving bothers you, but it bothers each and every one of us just as much. And I want to say that there's a spot in the church here that's going to be missing. You know, when you guys leave, you guys have special gifts, and we're all a body together. You know, your singing and your comments in Sabbath school class, and your hugs, your food, everything that you do. We just love you guys so much. And I want you to know that you're going to be prayed for, and you're going to be missed. And we love you. We love you very much. And we all mean that very much. And Miss Deborah here has got a little something for you. And Miss Patty. So we're from the church. This is from us to you guys.
This little token, Patty, yours in novelette with a lot of light. It says, memories made at the beach last a lifetime. And we know that we will love and appreciate you all lifetime. Because we plan on making heaven our home, we are looking forward to having more than a lifetime, an eternal lifetime together. That's from your church family. Wait.
We got a picture? Or
no? I'm going to see it.
Oh, that's right. You can put that up here. She's going to sing a song to you. All right. Great.
All around us, things are changing.
lovely ladies, we're not going to say goodbye. We're going to say until we meet again. Because we know that you're doing a work for your Heavenly Father, that you're going to take care of your mothers. And this is something that happens in life, and this is what we need to do. So we know you gals will be back. And we love you, and we'll be praying for you. All right, let's just have a word of prayer. Dear Heavenly Father, we want to thank you so much. Thank you so much that you love us beyond what our capacity to even understand what love is. I pray this day that we would start to get glimpses, that we would just come closer to you, because I just pray that you would reveal as much of yourself as that we can stand, Lord, and still live. Lord, please just open our eyes. Bring us closer to you.